Praise the Lord, everybody. This music is not mine. I do not own it, the rights to it. I want you all to just listen to Monumental Moments in the Word tonight in God's Word. Monumental Moments in God's Word. Yolanda Adams, this battle is not yours. Welcome tonight. Welcome tonight. Hi, Colleen. Hi, Anita. Glad you guys joined me. Praise the Lord. You're listening to Monumental Moments in God's Word with your host, Marla. We're going to be talking about expectations. Expectations. Just know that the battle's not yours, but it's the Lord's. Beautiful Sunday. Beautiful Sunday. No matter what you're going through. Hallelujah. Raise your hand and just worship with me. It's the Lord's. Hallelujah. Glad you joined me, Anita. God bless you. Hallelujah. 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 I thank God for the word on today because I had a marvelous, marvelous time in the presence of Lord today in Fredericksburg, Virginia. I went down there to a friend of mine's church, enjoyed the word with them. God spoke to the spirit of people and his word does not return unto us void. To God be the glory. I am glad that you joined me on my radio station, which is called Monumental Moments in God's Word. I am your host for this evening. And we're going to be talking about your life follows your expectations. What expectations do you have? Your life follows your expectation because expectation is a form of having faith. It is a form of faith. While hope may motivate us, we have to have hope. It motivates us. Expectation is the very next step which prepares for what we believe will happen. Have you all ever heard of stinky thinking? Well, that's what our pastor talked about. He didn't call it stinky thinking, but he did cause us to think on these things. Think on what, how we should really be acting, what we should really be, our perception of things and how we deal with life and its circumstances is very much how we decide to think on those things. And so I'm just glad to be before you in the presence of God this evening. But first, like I always like to start out, you know, there are certain things that is known for me. Hi, Mike Jackson. God bless you. And one of the things is my warrior's prayer, our warrior's prayer. Heavenly Father, your warrior, here I am again, Lord, prepared for battle. We're preparing ourselves for battle. Today, I claim victory over Satan by putting on the whole armor of God. Hallelujah. I put on the gird of truth. May I stand firm in the truth. May I stand firm in the truth of your word so I will not be a victim of Satan's lies. How many of us believe Satan sometimes when he lies to us? Sometimes we just believe certain things. I put on the breastplate of righteousness. May it guard my heart from evil. Hallelujah. So I will remain pure and holy, protected under the blood of Jesus Christ. I put on the shoes of peace. May I stand firm in the good news, in the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. So your peace will shine through me and be a light unto all that I encounter. I take the shield of faith. May it be ready. May I be ready for Satan's fiery darts, because you know he's going to throw them. He's going to throw those fiery darts. So I want to be ready for Satan's fiery darts of doubt, deceit, deception, and denial. So I will not be vulnerable to spiritual defeat. Next, I put on that helmet of salvation. May the helmet keep my mind focused on you so Satan will not have a stronghold on my thoughts. I take that sword of the Spirit. May that two-edged sword, which is the word of God, be ready in my hands so that I expose the tempting words of Satan. By faith. So I will have on the whole armor of God. I am prepared to live this day in spiritual victory. Are you able to live this day in spiritual victory? Good evening, Pastor Tony Blackston. How are you? May God bless you. I miss you guys up there in Baltimore. But you know what? God is still yet on the throne and he's still giving us the word. He's giving us the word. Every day. If you seek him, he is to be found. Praise God. Your entire life is ordered around what you expect to receive. How many of us expect to receive certain things from the Lord? Well, we should. We should expect to receive certain things from the Lord. Do you expect good things to happen to you or bad things to happen to you? You have to choose. How you answer this question or how you determine certain things is how you will live your life. Are you in great expectations for great things to happen, or are you constantly thinking that bad things will happen? Stinky thinking, guys. Stinky thinking. Hey, Jackson, God bless you. Expectation is a reflection of what we believe about God, about ourselves, and also about others. We believe that God, we should believe that God is the author and the finisher of our faith. So when we believe good things about God, ourselves, and others, we expect certain good things to happen around us. They should. We are surprised if they don't. In fact, when something bad happens to a person with positive expectations, they immediately begin to examine why. Why do certain things happen? Why did this happen to me? Because you got an expectation of something great happening. And when something doesn't go that way, you start asking why. Perhaps something is misleading or something went wrong or whatever. Perhaps this is a blessing in disguise. We like to think that because we're going through something and it's not to our liking, that it's not a blessing at the end of it. God says that he'll work all things together for our good to those that love God and are called according to his purpose. So why do we always think that when something is not happening the way we want it, that must be of the devil? Perhaps there is a lesson somewhere in that situation that God wants us to learn. Perhaps this is a stepping stone that we need to get and put under our feet so that we can climb higher. Everything that's happening that's not good doesn't mean that it's not good for us. The bottom line is that a person who lives in faith and applies that faith in future lives in expectation for God's goodness to estrouse them. In other words, I was thinking today as I was going to church, I was like, Lord, you know, I think back when I had my horrible car accident. I broke my neck in two places. I broke my back in three places. I was unable to really walk. I was unable to really feed myself. I was unable to really wipe my own behind. Okay, let's just be real. And I used to think, okay, what does God want me to learn out of that? Now, granted, I know the real reason. That deep down inside, when you walk away from the things of God, and when you walk and decide to run from what God is calling you to do, sometimes he will allow certain things to happen in your life to pull you back into his grace, into his by using his mercy and grace, if that makes any sense. Because for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans for your welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope. In Jeremiah 29:11, he know the plans for me. So when I was when I had that bad car accident and it broke my neck and back, and I wasn't able to do certain things, it was a chance for me to, he had to put me on my back for me to look up, to know that it was him that was calling me into his presence again. And sometimes we are stubborn. Sometimes we don't want to believe that's what God is allowing to happen for our growth, for our good. On the other hand, sometimes when someone expects bad things to happen to them, it can be a result of faulty thinking about God themselves and others. If you think about people in a bad way all the time, this translates into a faith that bad things will happen to them. You can't be always thinking negatively, I'm probably saying that wrong, when you do, they chalk it up to just another bad day in the series of a whole lot of bad days. But you know what? All of my good days, that's what it is. All of my good days outweigh my bad days, and I won't complain. Hallelujah. In my Myra Hughes voice, praise the Lord. Yes. They expect it as normal and it reaffirms what they have believed. Never do they examine it for a life lesson. We have to start thinking about the things that happen to us, good and bad. They are life lessons. Okay, so you go out and you have a child at a young age. Maybe you're not married. Okay, I understand that. But don't beat yourself up. Learn to live your life. Do what God calls you to do as a parent. Live your best life for the Lord and continue to move on. Do not, God bless you, Sophie. I love you too, sweetheart. Do not believe that just because that happened to you, that you are no good. Sometimes we tell ourselves so many bad things that we begin to believe it. But I want to speak into your spirit right now. Yes, you may have children. Yes, you may be struggling. Yes, it is hard. Yes, you may have made some mistakes. Pick yourself up. Dust your, you know how they used to say, flop that collar. Brush yourself off and keep living your life for the Lord the best way that you know how. The best way that you know how. Never do they examine it for lessons. You may not examine those things that you are learning for life lessons, but they are. They're things that are going on and happening just for a life lesson. It's a life lesson for all of us. It's a life lesson. And we can't think that we're too good for certain things to happen. We can't think that just because I got into this car accident and broke my neck and back, that it wasn't for my good, that there was nothing good that come out of it. Guess what? It did. Because God turned around and he blessed me. And he turned around and he was able to make me walk again and be able to lift my hands and be able to wipe my behind and to be able to put food in my own mouth. So I was blessed through all of the bad situation, but it taught me something. It taught me something. And that's what God is allowing. Not saying that you need to go through all that. I'm not wishing that on anybody. But sometimes things will happen to us to allow us to expect greater. We have to learn to expect greater. Anybody can change. And here are some ways to turn your expectation from bad things happening to you to good things happening to you. First, you must study the Word of God. Study the Word of God. The Bible says to study the Word, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the Word of truth. Study God's Word. Learn God's Word. Go to church. Go seek biblical counsel. Don't just always be listening to this person and that person and stuff. Get godly advice, but line it up with the Word of God. Next, determine to be purpose-driven inside of pleasure-driven. Sometimes we have to know that what we're doing, there is purpose behind it. Stop always doing stuff for pleasure. Pleasure is of the flesh. If you're always seeking pleasure, It can be selfish, and we're not selfless, I think is how I'm saying it. We're not selfless. Next, you want to define what kind of person you want to be. Who do you want to be in Christ? Who does God want you to be? More important, who does God want you to be in him? Stop trying to be like other people. Be what God wants you to be, and be it to the best of your ability. Find people who share your views and walk with them. Stop hanging around pigeons when you need to fly with eagles. You gotta share your vision. You have to share in like minds is what I'm trying to say. Look for things that affirm your belief and speak of those things. In other words, set your eye on the prize, which is Jesus, and allow him to show you what you should and shouldn't do. And look for those things to affirm your belief. And speak on those things. Speak those things as though they were. Those things that are not as though they were. Speak those things into existence. Accept what comes your way and build blocks for your future. Build blocks for your future. We are a people that, man, I tell you, we are a people that, I don't know, we just be doing all kinds of stuff. We be doing all kinds of stuff and not paying attention to the fact that I'm trying to get on my paper, y'all. So y'all have to excuse me because sometimes this computer be really crazy. But here we go. I think I'm getting to my paper that I had written up, Lord Jesus, because I'm trying to do. But anyway, we are. Let's see, where's my document? I think it's this one. Oh, okay. So, you know, so the thing about it is, I want to live my life with great expectation. Why is it that people are so tripped up when we expect the unexpected from God? And he does what we expect him to do. And then we act like we shocked because he does what we ask him to do. It absolutely blows my mind. And that is exactly how God blows our minds, with his goodness. With his goodness and his mercy. Whew. Yet, throughout the Bible, from Genesis all the way to Revelations, in God's basic instruction before leaving earth, which is the Bible, that's what Bible stands for, God always is found doing the unexpected. And I know in my own life, and being a living example, I have seen God reveal himself over and over through the unexpected. I have witnessed God in action from people of God to minister to people who do not know or did not know. I've seen people be ministered to that nobody even knew anything about them. I even witnessed that today. That's why you know you have to be in a spirit-filled church, a spirit-filled church with believers that are hearing from God. Because I experienced that today, going in a church where nobody really knows some people. And God spoke to these people through the man and women of God. And it just absolutely blows my mind to know that God yet loves us so much. He loves us so much that he will place people in our lives. And when he speaks into the spirit of people with God's anointing, they walk away knowing that that was God and God is real. That's when you know that you know that you know you're serving a God that you need to serve. That you're serving a good God. I've always believed that our faith resides in the truth of God's word. I have. I've always believed that my faith resided in the truth of God's word. But some people have never wanted or trusted anyone else enough to place their faith in someone else and their testimonies about what God is doing or has done in their life. Sometimes when people hear a word going forth, they many times, like the pastor, they feel like the pastor may be talking directly to them. That's the spirit of the Lord. Some people want to dismiss it and call it a stroke of luck. There's no such thing as luck. There's no such thing as luck. Then they will think they have something more substantial for their faith. It is, because I witnessed it again today. I said that he makes himself known. It isn't weird that a person can speak to you through the Spirit of God and truly not know anything about what you are, who you are, or what you've been through. But sometimes we need our faith restored. Sometimes God has to show himself to be real to some people, And he will speak through someone just so they know it is him. That's how he loves us so much, that he will do that for us. Was it a coincidence? No. Was it a happenstance? No. Was it the proof that that person needed to hear and see to believe? Was it that I had been praying that God chooses someone to speak to them through someone else and they speak a word of God to their spirit? Was it an answer to my prayers or an answer to someone else's prayers? James does say that every good and perfect gift comes from the Father of heavenly lights in James 1 and 17. Sometimes my faith is a very negative faith. I have to be honest. Sometimes it's negative. I have no problem expecting the unexpected in a negative way sometimes. And you all, if you're honest with yourself, let's raise your hands. Don't everybody speak at once. Sometimes you have experienced those moods where everything has gone wrong that could go wrong. And at those moments, you have all the faith in the world. It's just like Murphy's Law. If anyone can go wrong, if anything can go wrong, if anything that touches anything about me can go wrong, it's gone wrong. It's no trouble at all to believe that the next disaster that is going to happen is that the sky is going to fall or the roof is going to cave in. When it happens, you say, I told you so. I knew that was going to happen. I knew the worst was yet to come. Looking back on those situations, though, you may even begin to believe that there is something prophetic about your ability to predict those things, but it's really not. You think you're predicting the unpredictable. It's easy to be a prophet of gloom and doom. It's definitely easy of that. After all, we expect Satan to do the unexpected. We think he should do the unexpected to make our lives pure unbearable. And he does. Too often, we don't expect God to do the unexpected to redeem us from the unbearable circumstances. But God, in his infinite wisdom, in his grace, and in his mercy, God does the unexpected. And you know, the book of Acts is all about God doing the unexpected. Speaking in tongues, healing the crippled people, the apostles' deliverance from prison by the angel, Peter and John's deliverance from the Sanhedrin. God strikes Ananias and Sapphira dead. The death of Stephen initiating the spread of the gospel into Samaria. The eunuch's serendipity experience on his way back to Ethiopia. Saul's conversion on his way to kill other Christians. I could just go on and on and on. The first century had a hard time learning to expect the unexpected. The story of James' death and Peter's deliverance from prison in Acts testifies to this truth. As we look at Luke's account, hopefully we will begin to learn to expect the unexpected from God. Do you believe the unexpected from God? Do we expect the unexpected from God? Acts 12:1-19. It was about that time that King Herod arrested some who belonged to the church, intending to persecute them. He had James, the brother of John, put to death with the sword when he saw that this pleased the Jews. Thank you. That this pleased the Jews. He proceeded to seize Peter also. This happened during the Feast of the Unleavened Bread. Hallelujah. After arresting him, he put him in prison, handed him over to be guarded by four squads of four soldiers on each side. Herod intended to bring him out for public trial after the Passover. So Peter was kept in the prison, but the church was earnestly praying to God for him. So here we are, getting ready to expect the unexpected. The night before Herod was to bring him to trial, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers bound with two chains. And centurions stood guard at the entrance. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared, and the light shone in the ceiling, coming down from the cell, He struck Peter on the side and woke him up. "Quick, get up, Peter! Get up!" he said, and the chains fell off Peter's wrist. Peter must have been like, "Whoa! I know I prayed for this, but my God, my God!" Can you imagine what Peter was thinking? He said the chains fell off of his wrist. Then the angel said to him, "Put on your clothes and your sandals." And Peter, he did what the Lord said. He did what the angel of the Lord said. "Wrap your cloak around you, Peter, and follow me." The angel told him. Peter followed him out of the prison gates, but he had no idea that he didn't have any idea what the angel was doing was really happening. He thought he was seeing a vision. He could have even thought he was still dreaming. They passed the first and the second guard, and he came to the iron gate leading to the city. And I could just imagine Peter saying, wow, what did I do? Well, I don't even know how this even happened. I remember praying and singing and praising God all night long. But how did this happen where these chains are just off me? I'm really free. It opened for them. The prison doors just opened for them by themselves, and they went through it. Hallelujah. When they had walked the length of joy, she ran back with an opening without even opening the door. She ran back to her parents and said, you know, is Peter at the door? Is Peter at the door? Can you just imagine a small child and their daddy's knocking at the door and they haven't seen their daddy coming home from Iraq? And they're like, Lord, we've been praying that daddy comes home safe. And now here comes Peter. Peter's coming home. So the little girl is like, mommy, daddy, Peter's at the door. And they're like, you're out of your mind. Peter's locked up. When she kept insisting that it was Peter, it must be his angel. That's what they were telling her. But Peter kept on knocking. Peter was persistent. And when they opened the door and saw him, they were astonished. Again, expect the unexpected. Peter motioned with his hand for them to be quiet, because now he don't want people to know, these to appease the Jews, to enhance his political aspirations. We see that going on in the government right now. Herod kills James and seizes the imprisons Peter, fully intended to killing him. Herod takes every precaution to ensure the success of his plan. But you know what? We serve a good God, and we serve a God that can bring us out when everything else is against us, and we can become free. We can become free. Peter was kept in prison, but the church was earnestly praying to God for him. So when I said, is it because of the prayers of the saints? Yes, the Bible even speaks about the prayers of the righteous availeth much. So yes, they were praying for him. In the second scene of Acts 12, we find the believers in Jerusalem gathered at the home of John Mark, earnestly praying for Peter. Meanwhile, there was another scene going on at the prison. So I'm telling you this, to expect the unexpected. Stop putting God in a box as though he can't take care of what he can take care of. Do you know that he knew us before we were ever born? He knew us before we were ever conceived in our mother's womb. He loved us that much. Woo, my soul is full. My soul is full. Imagine, and expect the unexpectable. Live your life in expectation for God to continue to do great things. Just live your life according to the word of God. When the apostle Peter was put into the prison, we know that Peter had to have been a little fearful and scared. But their prayers for Peter might have been more of a eulogy than a prayer of release. They may have been thinking that the person at the door was an angel that was announcing his death. It was a little wonder they thought Rhoda was out of her mind. They even thought she just lost it, because she thought that she really wasn't hearing Peter when she announced the unexpected arrival of Peter. Peter's arrival was an unhand on. But we are unable to look up and to see the handiwork of God. When God does the unexpected, we have difficulty believing what God is doing. We have a hard time believing that. When God answers prayer in an unexpected way, we often have difficulty recognizing his answer. Even Peter, I was supposed to be going sitting down, I think it was, but I don't know. Somehow I got sick and I was up near the front, and I could hear the talking. But you know, every time I take a flight, I think about the intensity of all the work that's behind the scenes of the aircraft getting going off into the air, and all the behind work that is done for it to land. And you never really think about that when you're flying a lot of times, but I always think, man, there's a lot of work that has to go on. You got to have the people wiping the cleaning the plane, taking the food, whatever, in and out the plane, they have to switch pilots. There's just a whole lot of going into the air traffic controller. People have to be talking to the pilot. There's people that, the grounds people, the people that take the luggage, the stewardesses, just everything. But you know, that is the kind of thing taking place in eternity to ensure our safe arrival in heaven as we speak. Only it is on a much grander scheme of things. Angels are being directed. Heaven and earth is being moved in unexpected ways to accomplish God's will for our lives. God and his heavenly host are working around the clock, making sure that everything conforms to the purpose of his will, so that he may be glorified through his work in us. In him, we were also chosen, having been predestined according to the plan of him who works out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will, in order that we, who were the first to hope in Christ, might be for the praise of his glory. And you also were included in Christ when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. Having believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is deposited, guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possessions in the praise of his glory. Isn't God good? Isn't God good? When you think of the goodness of Jesus, when I think of the goodness of Jesus and all that he's done for me, my soul cries out hallelujah. I praise God. I thank God for saving me. I thank God for visiting me. I thank God. But if you visit a gallery where there is a good collection of religious art, you will find that the painters of former days loved a crowd to their work with representation of angelic beings. But you know what? I love God. And the reason we expect a little in our prayer is because we fail to see the God who is in charge of answering our prayers. A lot of times we don't believe that in our prayer that we serve a mighty big God that can do mighty big things. Obviously, believers got far more than what they anticipated. We are to pray expecting greatness. But we pray as though we expect very little. And we just be like, ho-hum, God did something great. So great that the disciples had a hard time accepting the answer. And he does the same thing for us. And we have a hard time accepting the answer or accepting what God's done for us. But I must confess that in difficult times, I don't always know what to pray for. And I don't know what to always expect. All I can do is ask God to intervene and give me his best to accomplish his will. And now I can confidently trust the Lord to give me what he wants to give me. And I'll accept it. God is good. God is good. Hey, Coco V, how are you doing? God bless you. God answers. His answer to prayer is comprehensive. We know that it's comprehensive. But God is good and his mercy endures forever. So I hope you all got something out of the word on tonight. I hope, expectantly trusting God's plan. There is another element of truth running through each scene of Luke's narrative. We must not overlook trust. We have to trust God. We have to trust God in every aspect of our life. We have to trust him to get us through. We have to trust him to bring us out. But you know, the whole bottom line and conclusion of this is the story is told of a small town in which there was no liquor. I'm thinking about this. And this town didn't have any liquor stores. Eventually, however, a nightclub was built right on Main Street. Members of one of the churches in the area were so disturbed that they conducted several all-night prayer meetings and asked the Lord to burn down the den of iniquity. Lightning struck the tavern a short time later, and it was completely destroyed by the fire. The owner, knowing how the church people had prayed, sued them for damages. His attorney claimed that their prayers had caused the loss. The congregation, on the other hand, hired a lawyer and fought the charges. After much deliberation, the judge declared, "It's the opinion of this court that wherever the guilt may lie, the tavern keeper is the one who really believes in prayer, while the church members do not." When we expect great things from God, there will always be those who think we are out of our minds. We are far from being out of our minds when we expect to experience great things as God unfolds his uniqueness, his comprehensive plan, piece by piece and bit by bit before our very eyes throughout our eternal lives. It's easy to get rid and get tired and give up in what we want in prayer, that we fail to see the answer knocking on our doors. The future of this church and the churches all around the nation and the church which is in us lies in the plan of Jesus Christ. Relies on God to save the souls in our community. What a good day. God bless you. I thank you. Continue to come in and watch me on Monumental Moments in God's Word. May God forever bless you and keep you. Hello, Sharon. God bless you, my cousin. God bless you. I just finished up my program with Monumental Moments in God's Word. You all take care and God bless you. Love you all.